The F-22 was supposed to be the fighter of the future for the United States Air Force. It was designed to go up against future fighter jets from the Soviet Union. Instead, the US became embroiled in low-intensity conflicts in the Middle East. Although the F-22 saw action in Afghanistan and flew overwatch in Iraq and Syria, it was generally overkill for most missions in these countries. The F-22 order started out as 750 planes when the program began in the 80s, but Lockheed Martin only ended up building 195. Now the F-35A is the future of the Air Force fighter fleet.
The F-35 is America's most expensive weapon system.
About 270 have been delivered so far, and the Air Force plans on buying 1,763 over the course of the program. International allies are also buying the F-35A, which helps bring down the overall price.
The jet tells you everything that's happening in the battle space. So now you've got a lot of time to sit back and make far better decisions, way better decisions than I ever did as an F-15 pilot, about where to put my airplane and how to accomplish the mission that I've been assigned to do.
But the high operating costs of the aircraft could prevent the Air Force from buying as many as were envisioned when the F-35 was first selected. Costly stealth features, design bloat, and delays have possibly pressured the Air Force to look for alternatives to fill in the gaps.
Ready.
The F-35A was designed to revolutionize fighter procurement for the Air Force. It was going to take the missions of several aircraft and do it all. The maintenance was going to be cheaper and easier due to cutting-edge computer software.
Back at its inception, the Pentagon had in its mind that this aircraft would be a master of all trades.
The F-35A has sold exceptionally well. 10 countries have all ordered the aircraft for their own air forces, and more potential buyers are considering the fifth-generation offering from Lockheed Martin. Because of the large number of orders, the cost per F-35A has gone down to $80 million per aircraft. That's actually reasonable when it comes to cutting-edge jet fighters.
We're positioned now to deliver anywhere between 155 to 165 F-35s annually.
Without a doubt, the biggest cost challenge that we face in the airplane is the life cycle sustainment cost of the jet. What I can tell you about that is the Air Force is laser focused on that. It is a constant topic of conversation with our teammates in the Joint Program Office. It comes up in every international discussion that we have, that we've got to find ways to make the airplane more affordable.
But the operating cost for the aircraft, which is around $36,000 per hour, is still about $10,000 more expensive than older fighters in the Air Force inventory.
Once it lands, that's not where it stops. That's not where the operating costs stop. There are a ton of sustainment and maintenance things that go into the F-35 because it's such a software-intensive fighter.
Not that it will be everything that it was promised to be, but it will be a totally transformative combat aircraft that just does things which we don't think of right now as things that fast jets do.
When we were talking about the cost per flying hour of an F-35, it includes all of those sorts of capabilities that in other airplanes, F-16, F-15, are not organic to the platform itself. There are things that hang either on centerline stations or on wing stations to help the airplane accomplish its mission.
The Joint Strike Fighter concept seemed like a great idea on paper back in 1992. One basic airframe that is modified to meet the requirements of several branches of the US military. The F-35A for the Air Force, the B for the Marines, and the C for the Navy. In practice, the concept has run into many problems.
For instance, the helmet that is used to fly the airframe, there's been problems with that. There's been an F-35 that is caught on fire on the flight line. And then anything that you can think of that would just normally go wrong on a manufacturing line, all of the logistics and supply items that go into that. I mean, there's just been a hiccup pretty much at every turn in developing this weapons platform.
The manufacturing of the F-35 involves almost every state in the U.S., thousands of jobs, and the involvement of international partners.
From an economics point of view, from an F-35, it's about 254,000 jobs across the United States. 48 states are involved in the manufacture of the support of the F-35. 1,800 suppliers across the U.S., $49 billion annually. Just a very strong economic engine for the United States.
Even though from the get-go the F-35 has had some problems, you now see more lawmakers backing the program overall because a lot of states are so involved in its manufacturing process. And of course, last year, that manufacturing process was brought even more stateside after Turkey was removed from the program.
As a combat aircraft, the F-35 is definitely not a failure. It's one of the most capable combat aircraft in the world, and it will only get better from here on out. It's more expensive than it should be. It's more expensive than it was promised to be, partly just because of the level of ambition that was poured into it.
The estimated lifetime cost of the program is roughly $1.6 trillion. Although the F-35 is an incredibly capable aircraft, the Air Force appears to have decided to diversify its fleet. The F-15EX, an upgraded version of the F-15 that first flew in the 1970s, is on the acquisition block, and the Air Force received its first F-15EX on March 11th of 2021. And recent comments by Air Force Chief of Staff General Charles Brown Jr. illustrated the possibility of procuring a light fighter to be a replacement for the aging F-16.
Yeah, as General Brown has said on multiple occasions, the Air Force, in concert with other key elements of the Department of Defense, are taking a good hard look at what the right fighter force mix should look like.
The idea that, because there are some affordability challenges, that the USAF is somehow going to just bail on this program is mad. Of course they have to consider the future fighter mix, because the sums don't add up and they haven't added up for a long time. And good on General Brown for grasping the nettle on that publicly.
We've heard from Boeing saying that the T-7 could be modified to have a combat role. And it also, there's an implication also if allies and international partners do buy into the program as well, because then they could create more, then they could build this network of aircraft and really, create a huge inventory and make it a global program similar to the F-35. It is an option for another replacement down the line. It's just a question of what is the T-7 capable of.
Meanwhile, the U.S. Air Force continues to invest in other technologies, such as uncrewed or semi-automated drones that could be used in combat. Recently, Boeing Australia flew an uncrewed drone as part of its Loyal Wingman program.
And we're excited about the prospects of how that capability moves forward, and not just how it supports our Royal Australian Air Force customer, but how it supports the global market.
The F-35 isn't going away. The United States has invested far too much time, money, and energy into it.
I think everyone wishes always that we could make the machine move faster. We're happy with what we've done with the airplane so far, but there are certainly challenges ahead in terms of the entirety of the enterprise, the government and industry team working together to ensure we get the capability that we need that is supportable and at a price point that is workable for not just the Air Force, but also our Navy and Marine Corps partners, the seven partner nations that are part of the F-35 enterprise, in the growing, ever-growing list of foreign military sales customers.
The F-35 program is, in essence, too big to fail.
Also because, with respect to things like concurrency, the way the program was spread across lots of different state districts to make it too big to kill, and all of these different aspects that overall increase program cost and delays. So yes, it's an example in many ways of how not to manage a program, but as a combat aircraft, what has been produced is ahead of anything being fielded by any competitors, and it will be the cornerstone of U.S. tactical air power for a long time to come.
But the promise of E-series aircraft, which refers to the digital engineering that is used to design them, could revolutionize how the Air Force buys aircraft.
So when looking at this E-series designator and a replacement, the Air Force is already looking to companies that are working in this way, in these innovative ways to bring in open architecture and digital engineering from the get-go, so that way later on the costs will not be skyrocketing, and it will be something that they have to deal with in the long term.
You look at what the Russians, the Chinese are doing, for example. It's very easy, comparatively speaking at least, to make something that looks and flies like a fifth generation jet. It is unbelievably difficult to make something that actually works like one is supposed to.
A lot of like-minded nations have chosen the F-35 to be their standard bearer for their various air arms, whether they be air forces or otherwise. And so, despite the challenges that we face in ensuring that we have the right kind of combat capability that we need, that we can fix the airplane when we need to fix it, and that we can afford it, it is absolutely an imperative that we get this right, because the United States, the three joint services within the United States, all of our partners and our foreign military sales customers are absolutely counting on the capabilities that this airplane provides.